Good morning, one and all. Today, the topic of discussion is about osteomyelitis. Coming to the introduction, the word osteomyelitis means osteo means bone and myelon means marrow, and it is inflammation of the bone marrow. And Nelaton coined the term osteomyelitis in year 1835. Coming to the definition, considering the extent of the bone involvement, osteomyelitis can be best described as an inflammatory condition of the bone that usually begins as an infection of the medullary cavity, which rapidly involves the Haversian system and quickly extends to the periosteum of the surrounding area. Coming to the microbiology of osteomyelitis, of all age groups, Staphylococcus aureus is the most common organism involved in the osteomyelitis, followed by Enterobacter species, Group A and Group B streptococcal species, and Haemophilus influenza. Predisposing factors for the osteomyelitis includes diabetes, autoimmune diseases, leukemia, severe anemia, malnutrition, syphilis, steroid drug abuse, and AIDS are the predisposing factors. Coming to the conditions that alter the vascularity of bone includes radiation, osteoporosis, osteopetrosis, Paget's disease of the bone, bone malignancy, and bone necrosis by mercury, bismuth, and arsenic poisoning. Coming to the pathogenesis, a localized area of infection which causes the inflammation, and inflammation leading to the increased intramedullary pressure, and that causes vascular collapse, which leads to ischemia. Ischemia leads to the avascular bone, and avascular bone acts as a source of infection, and there leads to the accumulation of pus and formation of edema. After formation of pus and edema, it enters into the Haversian system, followed by the elevation of periosteum, and this disrupted blood supply to the bone leads to the formation of sequestrum, which is a classical sign of osteomyelitis. Coming to the classification, based on the clinical course and radiographic features, osteomyelitis is divided into separate osteomyelitis and non-separate osteomyelitis. In case of separate osteomyelitis, acute separate osteomyelitis, chronic separative, in case of chronic, primary osteomyelitis and secondary osteomyelitis, and another includes infantile osteomyelitis. Coming to non-separate osteomyelitis, diffuse sclerosing osteomyelitis, focal sclerosing osteomyelitis, nothing but condensing osteitis, proliferative osteitis, also known as periosteitis ossificans, and Garry's sclerosing osteomyelitis, and finally the osteoradionecrosis. Coming to other specific types of osteomyelitis, these are include tuberculous osteomyelitis, brucellar osteomyelitis, syphilitic osteomyelitis, salmonella osteomyelitis, actinomycotic osteomyelitis, and fungal osteomyelitis. Coming to the overall general clinical findings, deep and intense pain will be seen, fever, malaise, anorexia, exudate, pus exudate, fetid odor, cutaneous fistulas, firm cellulitis of cheek, abscess formation, paresthesia or anesthesia due to nerve involvement, and regional lymphadenopathy. Coming into the detailed aspect of osteomyelitis types, the first variety is of growth, acute separative osteomyelitis. It is an acute lesion developed as a sequel of periapical infection. It often results in a diffuse spread of pus or infection throughout the medullary spaces, with subsequent necrosis of a variable amount of bone. And the patient complains of deep seated continuous pain in the affected area, intermittent paresthesia or anesthesia of lower lip due to the involvement of mandibular nerve, and swelling of the face. Coming to the clinical appearance of acute osteomyelitis, always it is associated with the caries state, teeth begins to loosen in the affected area and becomes sensitive to the percussion, and a fetid odor is seen, and mandible is more commonly affected than maxilla. The investigations in case of acute osteomyelitis, plain film radiography includes IOPR, occlusal radiograph, and pantomographic views. Microbiologic studies reveals a polymicrobial infection of organisms normally present in the oral cavity, and bone scan shows positive, and CT reveals more bone surface and helps in detecting sequestrum. MRI shows abnormal bone marrow edema. Radiographically, At this time, diffuse lytic changes begins to appear in the bone. Individual trabecula becomes fuzzy and indistinct, and radiolucent areas begin to appear. And this is the image of an acute osteomyelitis with a formation of sequestrum. The radiolucent body of a right body of mandible with central radio-opaque mass of necrotic bone, and those area of faint radiolucency is described by the white arrows in the diagram. Coming to the differential diagnosis, a periapical abscess, periodontal abscess, or a periapical granuloma, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, malignant neoplasia includes osteosarcoma, squamous cell carcinoma, and finally fibrous dysplasia. The treatment part, essential measures to be taken: bacterial sampling and culture, draining of the abscess, analgesics for pain relief, specific antibiotics based on the culture and sensitivity results, wound debridement, removal of the source of infection, and the adjunctive treatments include sequestrectomy, decortication of the bone, hyperbaric oxygen therapy, and reconstruction and resection for the extensive bone destruction. If obvious abscess formation is noted, antibiotic medications and drainage are indicated. The antibiotic medications most frequently selected include penicillin group of antibiotics, clindamycin, cefalexin, cefotaxime, tobramycin, and centamycin. Surgery may also be a part of the treatment, and ranging from simple sequestrectomy to the excision with autologous bone replacement. Coming to chronic suppurative osteomyelitis, this is the most common osteomyelitis type, usually caused by bacterial invasion from a contagious focus, mostly be used interchangeably with the term secondary chronic osteomyelitis, and it occurs as a sequela of acute suppurative osteomyelitis. Chronic suppurative osteomyelitis occurs especially in cases of inadequate removal of necrotic bone, early termination of antibiotic therapy, inappropriate selection of antibiotics, diagnostic failure and trauma, inadequate treatment for the fracture, or irradiation to the mandible. The most frequent sources of odontogenic foci are periodontal diseases, pulpal infection, extraction wounds, and infected fractures. This is the image showing an older individual affected by the chronic suppurative osteomyelitis in the left mandibular fascia. Intraorally, this pitch shows formation of sequestrum in case of left molar region. Patient may complain of mild, dull aching pain, swelling with pus discharge extraorally, paresthesia or anesthesia due to the nerve involvement in case of lower lip, pathological fractures may occur, and trismus is seen. Coming to the clinical appearance, associated with deep caries teeth, swelling occurs due to the formation of abscess, intraoral bone exposure, sinus formation, persistent stiffness leads to the formation of fistula, purulent discharge from the fistula, sequestrum formation. Also, sometimes it is associated with the tooth loss, pathological fracture may occur, and it is always painless unless it is secondarily infected, and regional lymphadenopathy is seen. Radiographically, at this stage of osteomyelitis, diffuse lytic changes in bone begin to appear, and individual trabecula become fuzzy and indistinct. Radiolucent areas begin to appear. The panoramic image shows ill-defined area of radiolucency of the right body of mandible adjacent to the recent extraction site. And this is the classical appearance of a chronic osteomyelitis, and it is called as moth-eaten appearance. To the investigations, culture and sensitivity testing should be carried out. Plain film radiography includes a periapical radiography, occlusal radiograph, and a panoramic radiograph. And the CT scan demonstrated the formation of sequestra and a periosteal U-form formation. To the differential diagnosis, Paget's disease, hypercementosis, fibrous dysplasia, early stage malignant bone tumor, osteogenic sarcoma, and fibrous dysplasia. Coming to the treatment, it is difficult to manage medically. Surgical intervention is mandatory and depends on the spread of the process. Antibiotics are safe as in case of acute condition, but are given through IV in high doses. Coming to the medical management, combination of antibiotics may be more successful than the use of single agents. For small lesions, curettage, removal of necrotic foam and saucerization are sufficient. For more extensive cases of osteomyelitis, decortication with saucerization should be done and is often combined with the transplantation of cancellous bone chips. In case of persisting osteomyelitis, resection of the diseased bone followed by immediate reconstruction with an autologous graft and pathological fractures should be immobilized and recalcitrant cases are treated with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Rationale for using hyperbaric oxygen therapy. This is related to its stimulation of vascular proliferation and collagen synthesis and osteogenesis. A regimen includes 100% oxygen at 2 atmospheric pressure for 2 hours per day for several weeks, almost 4 to 6 weeks. Coming to the chronic focal sclerosing osteomyelitis, it is also known as condensing osteitis. Coming to the definition, it is a proliferative medullary bone reaction to pulp and periapical infection in a person with high degree of tissue resistance and tissue reactivity. It is a localized area of bone sclerosis and it is a reaction to a low-grade inflammatory stimulus. And patient may complain of mild or no pain and patient is usually asymptomatic. Clinical appearance includes, it is most commonly associated with children and young adults and deep caries teeth is associated with this. Non-vital tooth commonly involved includes mandibular first molar associated with the apex of tooth with long-standing pulpitis, mostly found at the apex of mandibular first molars. Coming to the investigations, periapical radiograph and the pandromic radiograph. Radiographically, the lesion appears well circumscribed uniform radiopaque mass of sclerotic bone surrounding and extending below the apex of the tooth and with intact lamina dura and vital periodontal ligament space. This is an periapical radiograph of condensing osteitis showing increased area of radial density surrounding the apexes of non-vital mandibular first molar teeth. Coming to the differential diagnosis, radiographically it should be differentiated from the lesions which present with radiopaque mass attached or near to the tooth apex. And these are include benign cementoblastoma, focal cementosis dysplasia, periapical cementosis dysplasia, hypercementosis, idiopathic osteosclerosis, complex odontoma and osteoblastoma. This is a periapical radiograph showing a radio-opacity at the apical periapical region of mandibular right second premolar. This is a periapical radiograph showing periapical region of mandibular right first permanent molar. And the periapical radiograph shows an ill-defined radiolucency surrounded over a well-defined radio-opacity. This is an image of benign cementoblastoma. This is the pandromic radiograph showing involvement of left body of the mandible in molar region and the periapical region of left mandibular molar shows well-defined radio opacity surrounded by a radiolucency. Coming to the treatment, since it represents physiological bone reaction to the known stimulus, the inflamed pulp that stimulated the focal osteomyelitis should be treated. And the elimination of source of inflammation by extraction or endodontic treatment. If lesion persists and periodontal membrane remains wide, re-evaluation of endodontic therapy is considered. After resolution of lesion, inflammatory focus is termed as bone scarring.